Good morning. Our mass today is for Robert Willard and his daughter Roberta, an anniversary mass. The mass is requested by the family, and we're going to be celebrating the mass on the seventh Sunday of the Easter cycle. Our entrance antiphon. Lord, hear my voice, for I have called to you. Of you my heart has spoken, seek his face. Hide not your face from me. Alleluia.
Thank you.
may experience as he promised, until the end of the world, his abiding presence among us, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Thanks be to God.
Saint John. Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, so that your Son may glorify you, just as you gave him authority over all people, so that your Son may give eternal life to all you gave him. Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, the only true God, and the one whom you sent, Jesus Christ. I glorified you on earth by accomplishing the work that you gave me to do. Now glorify me, Father, with you, with the glory I had with you before the world began. I revealed your name to those whom you gave me out of the world. They belong to you, and you gave them to me, and I have kept your word. Now they know that everything you gave me is from you, because the words you gave me I have given to them, and they accepted them and truly understood that I came from you, and that they believed in you, that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those you have given me, because they are yours, and everything of mine is yours, and everything of yours is mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I will no longer be in the world, but they are in the world, while I am coming to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In our readings today, there is seemingly something that is rather disjointed, because traditionally, the first reading is to set up the gospel, and it is to reflect a basic idea which is going to be expanded in the gospel portion, and that does not seem to be the case today. But we'll get to that in a few moments. Looking at the gospel itself, in itself, we see something akin to the farewell speeches of Moses in the book of Deuteronomy. As Moses was preparing for the people to enter into the promised land, which the Lord would not let him enter because of a sin that was committed, brought about naturally by the people, he nevertheless gave Jews a series of instructions, sorry, the Hebrews, because they were not considered Jews as yet. They were not connected with the tribe of Judah. That will come in much later in terms of understanding. So Moses gives them the instruction and they go into the promised land led by Joshua. Now, in the passage today, Jesus is saying farewell to the disciples. He has finished giving them the instruction. This is chapter 17, the last of the four chapters, which form those farewell speeches in the Gospel of John. And Jesus is again talking about the intimacy that is connected between him, the Father, and his disciples, who will eventually become the leaders of his people. So all of this is going on in this passage over here before Jesus goes out to bring about the salvation of the world through his passion, death, and resurrection. So all of that is contained within here, including his prayer that they may be one as we are one, they may see my glory, and so on and so on. That is the gospel. Now looking at the first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, we have the very beginning chapter. And in this very beginning chapter, Jesus has already been taken up into heaven in the ascension. And this is the after time. And what happens now is that they go back to Jerusalem, all of them. And in Jerusalem, the disciples who will soon be the apostles are numbered by name. And something very interesting is being mentioned. They devote themselves to prayer with one accord, together with some of the women, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. So we've got a lot going on. But one of the things I want you to notice is that when they go back to Jerusalem, and Mary is with them, they are in a type of Advent situation. Someone is coming. That someone who is coming is the Holy Spirit of God. So they must go to wait for him. Just as the Jews had to wait for the coming of the Messiah for several thousand years before he came. And interestingly enough, Mary is in that group. Now she is included in that group, okay? And she would be included because St. Luke wrote the Acts of the Apostles. And she's included because Mary was there at the very beginning of the actualization of the incarnation and the redemption. In other words, if she was not there, if she did not say yes, there would be no incarnation. So Mary is essential to the beginning of this process that has now been completed by the beloved Son. He has returned to the Father, and now they are in that Advent period of waiting. And just as Mary held the child in herself for 9 months before his birth, so now she holds the community together in that upper room as they wait and they pray for the realization of Jesus' promise in the sending of the Holy Spirit. So Mary is profoundly essential to this. And after this, Mary seems to disappear. But that does not really happen. Because if you recall the Gospel of John on Good Friday, Mary is given to John as his mother, and she is given, and he is given to her as her son. So that means that Mary and John will be connected for a long period of time, and before she dies, she will have influence on John's thought and will help him, like a reminiscence, to prepare the gospel that he himself writes. She will also, no doubt, come into contact with both Matthew and Luke to provide them with information for the beginning of their gospels, where they tell the story of the glorious incarnation, which is going to start this whole process moving seriously in time. So this is a very important thing. She is also there, if you recall, at the foot of the cross, where the church is born from the wounded side of Christ, that font of mercy, that coming out of the church. Now she will be with the church in anticipation of the coming of the Holy Spirit. And she will be there at the chrismation of the church, when it is christened by the Holy Spirit in the sense of receiving him who will send. as Jesus promised in the Gospel of Matthew, by the Holy Spirit. He is present with us until the end of the age. All of these wonderful, beautiful, and marvelous things are in process. But now, like Mary and the apostles to be, in this time before Pentecost, we too must enter spiritually into the Advent of anticipation. And as Mary and the disciples of Jesus pray with great joy, anticipating the coming of the Holy Spirit, so we too, in this springtime Advent, must with one heart and voice pray, "Come, our Holy Spirit, come." I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascends into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who together with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sin, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, our prayer for the faithful.
For all the members of the church, especially the newly initiated, that they welcome God's presence in their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who flee persecution, that they find safe refuge. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the farmers and the ranchers who provide the world's food, that they receive a just reward for their labor. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have lost loved ones in the cause of freedom, that they be comforted by memories of noble service. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the members of this community of faith, that they take seriously their baptismal call to service. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick of the parish, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the deceased of the parish, especially for Robert Woodard and daughter Roberta, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Let us conclude the prayer together. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Alleluia.
Oh.
Pray that my sacrifice and yours will be found acceptable to God, who is our Father.
May the Lord receive his thanks under your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept the Lord the prayers of your faithful with these sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass on to the glory of heaven. And all of this we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us now give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation. At all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our holy Passover is sacrificed. He is the true Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. By dying he destroys our death, by rising he restores our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every man, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. That partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis I, our Pope, Edward Bernard, our Bishop Pro Tem, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the Holy Resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, to whom this church is consecrated, and Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, our patron saints, our Holy Father, Saint Benedict, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, may we merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. May the precious blood of the good Lord keep safe for eternal life. The communion pattern. Father, I pray that they may be one as we are one. Alleluia. What passes our lips as food, O Lord, may we possess in purity of heart, that what is given to us in time shall be a healing for eternity.
The act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Keep this day in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.